Okay, we're talking about the right to travel today. This is a U.S. Supreme Court case. The right to travel is part of the liberty of which a citizen cannot be deprived without due process of law under the Fifth Amendment. This right was emerging as early as the Magna Carta. Complete freedom of the highways is so old and well established a blessing that we have forgotten the days of the robber barons and the toll roads. The right to travel over a street or highway is a primary absolute right of everyone. The use of the highways for the purpose of travel is not a mere privilege, but a common fundamental right of which the public cannot rightfully be deprived. The right of a citizen to use the highways, including the streets of the city or town, for travel and to transport his goods is an inherent right which cannot be taken from him. Personal liberty largely consists of the right of locomotion to go where and when one pleases, only so far restrained as the rights of others may make it necessary for the welfare of all other citizens. The right of the citizen to travel upon the public highways and to transport his property thereon by a horse-drawn carriage, wagon, or automobile is not a mere privilege which may be permitted or prohibited at will, but the common right which he has under his right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Under this constitutional guarantee, one may therefore, under normal conditions, travel at his inclination along the public highways or in public places, and while conducting himself in an orderly and decent manner, neither interfering nor disturbing another's rights, he will be protected not only in his person, but in his safe conduct. And that's taken from American Jurisprudence, First Edition, Constitutional Law, Section 329, page 1135. The Supreme Court has recognized that personal liberty includes the right of locomotion, the right to move from one place to another according to inclination. And that's Texas case. The right of the citizen to travel upon the public highways and to transport his property thereon, either by carriage or by automobile, is not a mere privilege which the city may prohibit or permit at will, but a common law right which he has under the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. No one may be required to obtain a license in order to speak. Thus, the state can no more license the appellant's right to travel in his automobile than it could license his right to print or to speak, for they're all inalienable rights. U.S. Supreme Court. The right to operate a motor vehicle upon the public streets and highways is not a mere privilege. It is a right or liberty, the enjoyment of which is protected by the guarantees of the federal and state constitutions. And that's Adam versus City of Pocatello, Idaho. At common law, there is no precise limit of speed. A traveler by automobile must adopt a reasonable speed, and that's all it really needs. You just, again, it comes down to, if you think about it, as long as you don't impair someone else's rights, you can do anything you want. Speed limits are commercial for people carrying passengers or property for hire. That is what is subject to regulation. If you're using the roads for hire, carrying passengers or property for hire, then that is subject to regulation. Just traveling on the roads is not subject to regulation in any way. Traffic, commerce, trade, sale, or exchange of merchandise. This is talking about traffic, Bouvier's Law Dictionary, 1856 edition. So when they're talking about some Highway Traffic Act or some traffic act, it's all commercial, okay? So they're talking about truck drivers and bus drivers. It's traffic is commerce, trade, sale, or exchange of merchandise, bills, money, and the like. Transportation, you know, the Department of Transportation. Think about it. The states have a Department of Transportation, Texas Transportation Code. Okay, well, transportation is punishment. In the English law, this punishment is inflicted by virtue of sundry statutes. It was unknown to the common law. It is a part of the judgment or sentence of the court that the party shall be transported or sent into exile. And this is Bouvier's Law Dictionary, 1856 edition. So the transportation code is for commercial vehicles. That's all it's for. It's not for people traveling on the highways. A U.S. citizen upon leaving the District of Columbia and becomes involved in interstate commerce as a resident does not have the common law right to travel of a citizen of one of the several states. And so that's what they're talking about here is corporations. And again, carrying the passengers or property for hire. That's what a U.S. citizen is, a fictitious entity. A license is a privilege granted by the state and cannot possibly exist with reference to something which is a right to ride and drive over the streets. If we allow the city of Chicago to require the licensing of horseless carriages, how long will be the city of Chicago would want to require a license to ride a horse or to walk on the streets? This is Article 4 of the Articles of Confederation. The better to secure and perpetuate mutual friendship and intercourse among the people of the different states in this union, the free inhabitants of each of these states, paupers, vagabonds, and fugitives from justice excepted, shall be entitled to all privileges and immunities from free citizens in the several states, and the people of each state shall have free ingress and regress to and from any other state. And that's, again, the important thing here is that so people can travel amongst the states, but paupers, vagabonds, and fugitives from justice are accepted. Okay, so if you don't have any money, you don't have any rights. This and all of the state statutes provide the same thing. Remember, I said that carrying passengers or property for hire. It's fictitious entities, and this is the Delaware Code. A person means any individual, partnership, corporation, joint venture, or legal entity by of whatever name. There's a maxim of law called a justum generis, and it's a maxim of law for statute writing. And basically it says that that when they make a statute, they put certain the same kinds of things together in a definition. And so when you have a definition that includes partnerships, corporations, joint ventures, and legal entities, then an individual is another legal entity. It's a fictitious entity. The same thing down here in this next section. A person or whoever respectively includes corporations, companies, associations, firms, partnerships, societies, joint stock companies, as well as individuals. So in justum generis works again here, because they're describing a bunch of fictitious entities, but the word include also means that it's limiting, and most people don't understand that. There's lots of court cases and definitions, dictionary definitions that talk about it. We're not going to go into it here, but that's exactly what goes on. We cover that in Color of Law, and that's another presentation that I'm going to upload. So. This is talking about include and justum generis, okay? So that means that it's only these things, and they're all fictitious entities. Operator includes every person who has actual physical control of a motor vehicle, okay? So that's every fictitious entity. A license means any license pertaining to the licensing of persons. So that's fictitious entities again. No person shall drive a motor vehicle without first having been licensed under this chapter. So that it's only fictitious entities that can't do it if you're doing it for carrying passengers or property for hire. Again, all of this stuff, if you watch the presentation on bar members and on bankrupt corporate governments, Unidroit, all of this, anything to do with motor vehicles falls under Unidroit and the United Nations. And so this is actually there's every state there's two states. There's a the courts have even talked about it, where there's a state of Texas in upper and lower case, and there's a state of Texas in all block capital letters. And so the all block capital letters state of Texas is actually a federal territory, so this is all for the federal territory. That's exactly what this is, which falls under the UN. And Texas Transportation Code. Remember, at common law, transportation is unknown at common law. Person means an individual, firm, partnership, association, or corporation. Okay, so a person is a fictitious entity. The Texas Government Code. A person's a fictitious entity. It's listing a bunch of fictitious entities there. Operator is a person. A peace officer can only arrest persons. Police officer, actually. He's a police officer. He's not a peace officer. Of course, he can be a peace officer. Texas Transportation Code, speed signs. The department shall erect and maintain on the highways and roads of this state appropriate signs to show the maximum lawful speed for commercial motor vehicles, truck tractors, truck trailers, semi-trailers, truck semi-trailers, and motor vehicles engaged in the business of transporting passengers for compensation or hire. Okay, again, so the speed signs are only there for commercial vehicles. They're not for people that are just traveling on the highways, going to work or with their private property. It has nothing to do with those people. Texas Transportation Code, maximum speed requirement. An operator may not drive at a speed greater than is reasonable and prudent under the circumstances then existing. An operator may not drive a vehicle at a speed greater than is reasonable and prudent. And this is what this is basically what that court case says that we talked about earlier, that says that at common law, there is no speed limit, that you go what's prudent. You go, again, as long as you don't damage someone's person or the property on the road, then there's nothing anybody can do that. Do at common law, there's got to be an injured party. Texas Transportation Code definitions. Driver's license means an authorization issued by the department for operation of a motor vehicle. And includes a temporary license and an occupational license. Okay, an occupational license is for truck drivers and bus drivers, and a temporary license is for a learner's permit. Maryland Transportation Code. Every state that I've been in and looked into is the same kind of stuff. Person includes an individual, receiver, trustee, executor, administrator, fiduciary. It's all fictitious entities. A driver means an individual. Okay, so that's a person and that's a fictitious entity. Canada Interpretation Act in the communist country to the north of us, with all of the judicial whores that have sold themselves to the bankster thieves in the United Nations. In every enactment for greater certainty, Canada includes the internal waters of Canada and the territorial sea of Canada. And then in every enactment, a person is any word or expression description of a person that includes a corporation. So it's all fictitious entities. And Canada is Admiralty Maritime Law. So these hired thugs on the roads that they call themselves peace officers, but they're breaching the peace every time you turn around, especially the border pigs. They go and assault you. It's all Canada. It's all Admiralty Maritime Law. And they're nothing but a bunch of pirates. In every act and regulation, a person includes a corporation. This is the Legislation Act of Ontario. A Highway Traffic Act of Ontario. In this act, driver means a person who drives a vehicle on a highway. This is Title 18, United States Code, Section 31. So remember, all of this stuff falls under Unidroit. So all of these state acts that we've been going through are all for a federal territory that sits in the same area as the state of Texas or any other state. And so this applies. And the term motor vehicle means every description of carriage or other contrivance propelled or drawn by mechanical power and used for commercial purposes on the highways. And used for commercial purposes on the highways. The term used, and it even defines what used for commercial purposes means. It means the carrying of passengers or property for hire. This is a Georgia Department of Driver Services letter. And what happened is I just put in the text of what was in the letter. The statute creates a rebuttable presumption. In other words, it's color of law. When we go through the color of law presentation, we'll see that. The statute creates a rebuttable presumption of residency for anyone who meets the following criteria. However, no such person shall be considered a resident for purposes of this chapter unless such person is either a United States citizen or an alien with legal authorization from the U.S. Immigration and Naturalization Service. So, again, a United States citizen is a fictitious entity. So it's only for people that are doing it for hire. Now, this is the communist country to the north of us, the pirates. Alberta Interpretation Act. Person includes a corporation, heirs, executors, administrators, or other legal representatives of a person. A Traffic Safety Act. Gee, that sounds like a commercial. Driver means a person who's driving or in actual physical control of a vehicle. Saskatchewan Interpretation Act. Person includes a corporation, heirs, executors, administrators. It's all fictitious entities. Saskatchewan Traffic Safety Act. You know, these bar members, and I encourage everybody to watch this, my bar member video, because it goes through it in great length. These bar members lay awake at night dreaming up this stuff to make it as complicated and difficult to understand as possible. But at the end of the day, what this thing says is a person may apply for a driver's license, which is a fictitious entity. And if you're not a person, then it doesn't mean anything. When the parliament uses general words like all persons and all residents, they're only talking about persons or residents who are properly within their jurisdiction. That's the Supreme Court of Canada. And, you know, again, these bar members like to make it nice and vague so that their hired thugs can go out and assault you based on these commercial codes, rules, and regulations. And under the UN, the United Nations, and that's really the problem. So that when it comes the time that we're stringing them up and hanging them by their for sedition and treason, that they can say, well, we put it in our court cases. Oh yeah, right. CBC versus Ontario. Again, it's all about plausible deniability, and this is Supreme Court of Canada. Parliament can only implicate a sovereign citizen by express mention or clear implication. So are you a person? A sovereign is not a person as far as the statute's concerned. A person is a variety of entities other than human beings. A person is foreigners and not citizens. In common uses, the term person does not include the sovereign. The statutes employing the word are normally construed to exclude it. And a sovereign is not a person in a legal sense. These are Supreme Court cases. Residents, as distinguished from citizens, are aliens who are permitted to take up a permanent abode in the country, being bound to the society by reason of their dwelling in it. They are subject to its laws so long as they remain there, and being protected by it, they must defend it, although they do not enjoy all the rights of citizens. They have only certain privileges which the law or custom gives them. Permanent residents are those who have been given the right of perpetual residence. They are a sort of citizen of a less privileged character and are subject to the society without enjoying all its advantages. Their children succeed to their status, for the right of perpetual residence given them by the state passes to their children. And this is taken from the Law of Nations by Vattel, Book 1, Chapter 19, Section 213, page 87. So now let's look at this a little bit closer. So a permanent resident is a type of a citizen. There's two classes of citizens. There's at least two. Their children succeed to their status, and so they're still a resident. So that when the hired thugs at the border want to know what your residence is, that's what they're trying to do, is they're trying to convert you into one of their slaves. One does not necessarily become a non-resident by absconding himself or absenting himself from his place of abode. That's the Missouri Court of Appeals. And essentially what they're saying is that it's all in what you say. It's all in what you say. All you have to do is say that it's not a residence. Driver, one employed in conducting coach, carriage, wagon, or other vehicle. That's Bouvier's Law Dictionary, 1856 edition. Black's Law Dictionary, first edition. Driver, one employed in conducting a coach, carriage, wagon, or other vehicle. So it's employees. It's people doing it for hire. A driver, this is Black's second edition. One employed in conducting a coach, carriage, wagon, or other vehicle with horses, mules, or other animals, or a bicycle, tricycle, or motor, or other motor car, though not a street or railroad car. Black's Law Dictionary, fourth edition. One employed in conducting a coach or motor or other vehicle, and it also talks about motor cars. Person actually doing the driving while employed by owner to drive or driving his own vehicle. Operate. This word, when used with relation to automobile, signifies a personal act in working with the mechanism of the automobile, as the driver operates the automobile for the owner, but the owner does not operate the automobile unless he drives it. So So the operator and the driver can be the same person, but they can also be separate people. It will be observed from the language of the ordinance that a distinction is to be drawn between the terms operator and driver. Operator of the service car being the person who is licensed to have the car on the streets in the business of carrying passengers for hire, while the driver is the one who actually drives the car. However, the actual prosecution of the business, it was possible for the same person to be both the driver and the operator. Operator and driver, I should say. The reason for the initial detention, speeding and running a red light are not a breach of the peace. So when these peace officers are, they're not peace officers, actually. When they stop you for speeding or running a red light, they're not peace officers. They breach the peace, and they're hired thugs, especially if you're not carrying passengers or property for hire. If you are carrying passengers or property for hire, then they have every right to do it. But if you're not carrying passengers or property for hire, then they're hired thugs. They just breached the peace, and they assaulted you. That's exactly what it is. If there's no breach of the peace and you are not carrying passengers or property for hire, then it's an unlawful arrest. Any restraint, however slight, upon another's liberty to come and go as one pleases constitutes an arrest, a detention. You know, this is one of the things they like to say, oh, this is just a detention. Well, I am sorry. If I'm arrested, if I'm not free to go, I'm arrested. Detention is the act of retaining a person or property, preventing the removal of such person or property. If you're not free to go, you're arrested. An illegal arrest is an assault and battery. The person so attempted to be restrained of his liberty has the same right to use force in defending himself as he would in repelling any other assault and battery. One may come to the aid of another being unlawfully arrested, just as he may where one is being assaulted, molested, raped, or kidnapped. Thus, it is not an offense to liberate one from unlawful custody of an officer, even though he may have submitted to such custody without resistance. And so that's exactly what they do, is they unlawfully arrest you, and it's an assault. That's exactly what it is. This is a Canadian, this police manual of arrest, seizure, and interrogation by the Honorable Roger E. Salhaney is a Canadian judge. And similarly, a person cannot be convicted of resisting a peace officer in the execution of his duty unless the officer was acting strictly within the limits of his power and duty. If the officer makes an unlawful arrest, then there's a common law right to resist that arrest. And so that's why I coined the phrase. Actually, a lot of people coined the phrase. I mean, I've known this acronym for a long time, and it's PIG, because that's exactly what they are. A PIG is an acronym that stands for persons in government who intend to perjure their oath, and that's exactly what they are when they assault you with their unlawful arrest. So what they do, the standard procedure is to drag you into their kangaroo court because it's statutes they're enforcing. When you're not involved in carrying passengers or property for hire, then that's exactly what it is it's a kangaroo court. Judges who become involved in enforcement of mere statutes, civil or criminal in nature and otherwise, act as mere clerks of the involved agency. It's a kangaroo court. A judge ceases to act, set as a judicial officer, because the governing principles of administrative law provides that courts are prohibited from substituting their evidence, testimony, record, arguments, and rationale for that of the agency. Additionally, courts are prohibited from their substituting their judgments for that of the agency. It's a kangaroo court. It is the accepted rule that not only in state courts, but of the federal courts as well, that when a judge is enforcing administrative law, they are described as mere extensions of the administrative agency for superior reviewing purposes as a ministerial court for the agency. It's a kangaroo court. Judges in these kangaroo courts are actually not judges, but clerks, and they have no immunity whatsoever. When enforcing mere statutes, judges of all courts do not act judicially and thus are not protected by qualified or limited immunity. It's a kangaroo court. Judges loses his absolute immunity from damage actions only when he acts in clear absence of all jurisdiction or performance of an act which is judicial, not judicial in nature. They're a bunch of pirates. Qualified immunity protects government officials from liability for civil damages insofar as their conduct does not violate clearly established statutory or constitutional rights of which a reasonable person would have known. qualified immunity defense fails if public officer violates clearly established right because reasonably competent official should know the law governing his conduct. So what, at common law, they don't have a shred of immunity, so they go and pass statutes that give themselves immunity so they can go ahead and violate your rights, and you got to get one of these judicial whores to try and enforce common law. In doing this, I shall have occasion, incidentally, to evince how true it is that states and governments were made for man, and at the same time how true it is that his creatures and servants, first deceived, next vilified, and at last oppressed their master and maker. A state like a merchant makes a contract, a dishonest state like a dishonest merchant willfully refuses to discharge it. That's what these whores are doing, these United Nations judicial whores. This is Chisholm versus Georgia, 1793, just shortly after the revolution. They had it all fresh in their mind when we had some decent judges back then. And this is the kind of stuff that they're doing again today. This has been going on and on and on. If you go into the bankruptcy, the bankrupt corporate so-called governments, this has been happening for centuries. It's the same things that keep coming back around because we the people don't seem to get the message, and these government pigs keep bringing it back around again and again. It's all about slavery. A person is property. A slave is a slave because he's considered property. Either you're the king or you're a slave. There is nothing in between. If you participate in their color of law statutes, then you've agreed to be their slave. It's only involuntary servitude that's not lawful. All of this is brought to us thanks to our bar member friends. You can learn more about our bar member friends in the bar members video, in the corruption in the courts video, in the peace officers video, in the upcoming corruption in the courts number 4 video, in the upcoming fire the whores in Texas video, in the upcoming city of Fort Worth pigs video, in the upcoming city of Grand Prairie pigs video, in the upcoming Canada border pigs video. All of this is brought to us by bar members both off the bench and on the bench. The motivation of these de facto so-called justice judges is not for justice, but maybe if you're lucky, for the appearance of justice, which is covered in corruption of the courts number 4. And so they are not competent to do justice. They're all UN de facto whores selling their justice, and they have no interest in, they're just nothing but thieves. Now, that's not to say that some of them aren't good. There's no doubt that some of them are interested in doing justice, but those ones, the best you'll ever see is the appearance of justice. And these whores intend to create business for the so-called court to justify their existence, to create work for their de facto buddies, to collect more royalties, and to get promoted to the Court of Appeals or the Supreme Court. They create work for their buddies by making their decisions as cryptic as possible, by forcing the issue to another hearing, by ignoring the law and thereby forcing an appeal. Do you want to place your future in the hands of the United Nations whore who wants to sit on the bench and play stupid? Do you want to put the future of your wife and children in the hands of these judicial whores that have complete immunity no matter what, because if you sue one of them, you have to get one of their whore buddies to do it? Sure, some of them want to do justice, but are you going to take the chance that you've got a good one? Do you want to place your future in the hands of a whore that is bought and paid for by these crown pigs in Canada and in the U.S. or elsewhere? And it's crown pigs in the U.S. too. Do you want to place yourself in the hands of a judicial whore who is intent on converting you into a ward of the court, which is an imbecile? Do you consider yourself a Christian? Do you try to follow the golden rule? Do you treat other the ways that you want to be treated? Do you think that you're going to get any sympathy from God on Judgment Day when you've not done everything you can to put a stop to these satanic judicial whores selling their justice? There's a thing called karma. What goes around comes around. It's the universal principle of what goes around comes around. If we knowingly allow these judicial whores to victimize tens of thousands of people in the name of their satanic religious ceremonies, don't you think that we'll be held accountable? Don't you think it will come back around at us? Don't you think it's already coming back around at us every day when they sell their justice in their de facto so-called courts, when their revenue officers masquerading as police officers unlawfully arrest us for commercial crimes like speeding, when they deny us due process based on one of their fictitious quasi-contracts, when they populate their prisons with victimless crimes? all judges are foreign agents of the Vatican. See the bar member video. This idea of separation of church and state was really about taking Christianity out of government and displacing it with the satanic Roman civil law from the United Nations and the Vatican. These so-called, all so-called courts are actually a satanic religious ceremony by priests of Baal. Bar members are priests of Baal. Under the guise of the separation of church and state, they've taken the Lord's Prayer out of the schools. They've taken Christian symbols out of the schools. They've taken Christian symbols out of the courts. They've converted our Christian government into satanic government. And all of this is done by court rulings from the priests of Baal masquerading as judges. And if you have any doubt about that, watch. There's a guy by the name of Mark Passio that's done YouTube videos about natural law. And he's a former Satanist priest. And he goes through the pillars of Satanism and how our society is a satanic society. And this is all done by these judicial whores that are foreign agents of the Vatican. At common law, the jury has to be your peers. At common law, the jury calls the witnesses, questions the witnesses, determines the law and the facts in the matter, and even pronounces sentence if necessary. At common law, the jury can disregard the law. That's called jury nullification. Look it up on the internet. It's thousands of years old. At common law, the jury can do literally anything it wants. At common law, there are no prisons. That's why common law is so severe. All prisons are commercial. Most of the people in prisons are there for victimless crimes. We need to fire these whores and end the tyranny of these de facto United Nations courts and their Vatican judicial whores selling their justice. Our court is only a jury of our peers, and we are all being denied it so these judicial whores can populate their prisons and collect their royalties. When governments collapse in countries like Libya, the first thing that happens is they kick all the prisoners out of the jails. All jails are commercial. My conscience is clear. As far as these Canada border pigs are concerned and their hired judicial whore, Redmond, they should have murdered me when they had the chance. Because by the time I'm finished with them, they'll wish they did murder me, and I'll do it all within the law. Canada has the best justice system money can buy. Rook is one of the ringleaders, and Athel, the whore in Alberta, and Johnston, the whore in Canada, and Harper and his pigs, and Elizabeth, the bitch, and her pigs. Judgment Day is coming, and I'll be there demanding justice. I intend to see them all in hell. If I'm really lucky, I'll get to see them do that little dance they do at the end of a common law rope. We all need to work together to bring these whores to justice. I'd like to see some of these whores do that little dance they do at the end of a common law rope. I'm very glad it's not up to me, it's up to a jury of my peers. I would never take the law into my own hands, because that would defeat the purpose of everything I'm trying to do. I'm trying to make it better for everybody. We are in the middle of a world shift. Every 100 years, give or take, there's a world shift from the beginning of recorded history for the last 3,500 years. It is really only 3-5% of the people who do anything. It was 3-5% of the people who precipitated the American Revolution. The bankster thieves and their cronies are 3-5% of the people. The last world shift was 1913 to 1934. The previous world shift was 1776 to 1793, I think. Anyways, these world shifts have been happening every century, give or take, for the last 3,500 years of recorded history. The world shift is either to more freedom or more force. The last world shift was towards more force. This one is currently started, but it's going to happen in the next 10 or 15 years, and it's towards force. But we can affect a change. And that's what this life leadership is trying to do, is they want to educate people and raise up leaders to affect a positive change towards more freedom. What they do is they provide educational material about what the issues they are, and they provide a way of bringing people together. And so they basically provide CDs and DVDs and books, reading material, but they talk about more than freedom. They talk about you have to have balance. You got to have finances balanced. You got to have your family is important, and so we need to have balance in our life, and so and all of this they provide a way of generating revenue through network marketing. This is their website, and there's the 8 F's in the bottom: faith, family, finance, fitness, following, freedom, friends, and fun. And so following his leadership, fitness, finances, family, faith, it's all part of the balance. Some of the CDs and DVDs that are available cover Rascal Radio, potential constitutional changes. One of the things they say about constitutional changes is that they don't have all the answers. If anybody has better ideas, they're open to other ideas, but don't criticize just to criticize. If you're going to criticize, then present an alternative idea and do it that way. They also talk about leadership development, corporate leadership. Some of their leadership material is used by airlines and corporations. Financial fitness is important. Adversity talks about adversity and success and balance your life and spiritual and financial and all of that. They do not just sign you up and leave you on your own. They want you a minimum of 10 people deep. They'll actually put people under you. Their charts show you 20, 30, 50 feet people deep. They need you to be successful so you can have influence and be a leader. We need 3 to 5% of the people as leaders so we can work together to affect the world shift towards freedom. They have meetings every Tuesday night in DFW at the Omni Hotel on 635 east of the George Bush Toll Road. And there's other meetings, and contact me if you have any questions, or you can probably find stuff on their website. Nobody said it would be easy, but it is possible. And so there's upcoming border events. There's going to be one on the Canada border pigs. There's corruption in the courts for. There's fire of the whores in Texas. There's the city of Fort Worth pigs, the city of Grand Prairie pigs. Copies of these documents can be provided, found in my private group at Yahoo called Administrating Your Public Servants. And I have YouTube videos that I encourage you to watch. I appreciate you watching today. Send me an email for copies of the documents to Engineer Wynn. I appreciate you watching, taking time to watch my rant today, and I hope you have a nice day.